All psychologists know the name of Charles Bonnet on account of the syndrome to which he gave his name, or his name has been given. He observed in his 87-year-old grandfather vivid hallucinations in the complete absence of psychosis. In fact, his grandfather was very entertained by these hallucinations. It's a syndrome that occurs quite frequently in older people who have visual difficulties, visual impairments, such as macular degeneration. Bonnet's grandfather had cataract operations, which is rather interesting to a visual scientist. Born in 1720, Bonnet married well, lived comfortably and very quietly. As far as I can establish, he never left his native Geneva. He was trained in the law, but never practiced. And as a young man, he occupied himself very fruitfully with botany and with entomology, and still in his 20s was elected to the Royal Society of London and to the French Academy without ever leaving Geneva. But he turned, as his eyesight deteriorated, turned, as many do, to theoretical cognitive neuroscience. And what's not realised, I think, generally, is that it's a very sophisticated constructionist theory that lies behind his interest in the Charbonnet syndrome. So, his first book on psychology, on the mind, he pretended, or his publisher pretended, that was published in London, and the author is not given, this is 1755. Even in Geneva, these materialist views were dangerous. And in this essay on psychology, he sets forward the question that is this talk is about. So he says, if all our concepts, even the most abstract, depend ultimately on motions that occur in the brain, it's appropriate to ask if each concept has a particular fiber dedicated to produce it, or whether the same fiber, activated in different ways, produces different ideas. In modern terms, the issue is this. The brain is, we agree, the brain is a network of neurons, but centrally, how far is it a neural net in the modern computer science sense, where information is embedded in the net itself, in the signs and weightings of the connections between the nodes? Or is it centrally a communications network where the same physical substrate can carry different information from moment to moment? I'll be elaborating on this. Now, Bonnet himself believed in Gnostic units, grandmother cells. He deals with this extent, sort of cells that represent particular people, particular concepts, particular words. So he says, doesn't each sort, each kind of visual perception have in the brain its dedicated place? Doesn't it have fibers that are dedicated to it and are not dedicated to anything else? So he gives an example, and this is his theory of memory, which of course is intimately connected in the connectionist model. So he takes the word ostracisma, and when those fibers are activated, they slightly more weakly activate the concepts of banishment and 10 years, proper meaning of ostracism, and even more remotely activate cells that are representing general pain. that's expressed here. So here's the dichotomy that I'm considering. We have plenty of models in our world that represent these two. In a neural net, the response of any cell is fixed at any one time. Of course, plastic can change over time, and it's determined by the connections in the net. What a given node represents may or may not be obscure. It may be a feature, but it may be very obscure. And the representation may be localist, or it may be distributed. In a communications network, such as the modern internet, the same physical substrate carries different information from moment to moment. So if you consider bits passing along the fiber optics of the internet at any one moment, they may be parts of headers that are giving the destination and the origin of the message. They may be representing part of a number or part of an alphanumeric character or a pixel or a control character. All transmitted by the same channel. Now, the two models imply different kinds of engram. That's another talk, but that they it's very important to realize that in this kind of model, storage is embodied in, and processing are not separated. In a communications network, storage and processing are separated. And you'll recognize that what I'm talking about is the great, grand, unsettled issue of symbolic AI versus connectionism. But I want to concentrate just on white matter. White matter, of course, it's called white matter because of the insulating sheath, myelin, that covers the axons. Modern diffusion tensor imaging has made the white matter wonderfully and marvelously colored. It constitutes 42% of the volume of each hemisphere. Rather little discussed by psychologists, nevertheless, but very interesting. The axons are almost all coming from pyramidal cells in the cortex. So what I'm concerned with is what is the information that's been carried by the long-range tracts within and between the hemispheres. The corpus callosum, of course, and the tracts within the long tracts within a hemisphere, such as the occipital frontal fasciculus, the arcuate fasciculus, and so on. And secondly, I want to discuss what are the protocols, the transmission controls protocols, TCP, that control transmission over this network. Human experience is of engineers is that you can't run a network without control signals. There's another interesting question that's not being discussed. It's very curious these questions are not discussed at all, despite the intense interest in the connectome. If you take a cross-section of any of the great tracts, corpus callosum, the arcuate fasciculus, you find a huge variation, at least a tenfold variation, in the diameter of axons. So each of these discs is an axon, this is a section through a tract, and this line represents how the diameter was taken for measurement. And you see this huge variation in size. Now, you will probably know that transmission time is much shorter with large axons. On the other hand, large axons are very costly in volume, but also in energy expenditure. Here in Cambridge, we're very aware of Simon Loughlin's teaching that a very important constraint on the brain is the cost of action potentials. One action potential costs you 10 to the power 10 ATP molecules. And the calculations are that only one neuron in your head can be active at any one time, otherwise you'd be burning out. So why is there this vast variation? Here are some numbers from two different tracts. So you can see on the x-axis here, this is the width of axons, the distribution is skewed, but there's a tenfold variation here, and there is this minority population of very large axons. Why is this? No one discusses it. I'll return to the question later. Now, the early stages of sensory analysis do resemble a neural net. Here I've depicted human weasels, early hierarchical model. So you take cells at an early level that have some fairly straightforward receptive fields, centered around. You wire them up to make cells in V1, visual cortex, that have oriented bar-like receptive fields. And human weasel were able to follow this hierarchy as far as higher order hypercomplex cells, which respond to corners. Well, when this material came out, of course, people were very ready to extrapolate. The most sophisticated extrapolation in the 1960s was by a great Polish electrophysiologist, Konorski, and he called the cells 20 synapses further on that responded to a person, a word, an object, or your grandmother, Gnostic units, and that's the term I'll use for these. Now, when you talk to modern neurophysiologists, even though the whole literature is pervaded with the idea that centrally cells are responding to particular things, they say, well, it's metaphor. I mean, we don't really believe that. But here's, just as an example, is an unashamed model of word recognition, but from to N, where he identifies the visual areas, striate and pre-striate, as far as the occipital temporal sulcus. And these are the receptive fields. This is human weasel down here, and then it goes on, and you have cells in the occipital temporal sulcus on the left side that are specific to particular diagrams or short words. And Treisman was the first to postulate these, our greatest graduate. The standard alternative to Gnostic units is ensemble coding, or population coding. It turns out that most forms of ensemble coding share a deep difficulty with Gnostic units, not all of them. And I'll be discussing this later in the talk before you say, oh, it's all ensemble coding. Now, no one, of course, has found a Gnostic unit, because it's very unlikely you'd be able to match your microelectrode in the 10 to the power 10 cells there are in our heads to the Gnostic unit for an arbitrary image. Well, you will say, well, what about Jennifer Aniston neurons? These are found in the medial temporal lobes. The recordings are made from patients who are waiting for surgery for epilepsy in California. And they're alert, they're looking at a laptop, and on the laptop, in a brief half-hour recording, are shown many images. And cells are found that respond to many different images of a particular actress, or even to her name, and don't respond to other images shown in that session. But these can't be considered Gnostic units. You have to consider the cells that got away. If, in a brief recording session, they can identify, they can find a cell that responds to Jennifer Aniston, then there must have been millions of other cells that would have responded if they tried in their short session. And equally, they only took a small subset of the images that the person could recognize, so there would have been other images that perhaps any given cell would respond to. We can put numbers on this. They did in one of their papers the probability that cell responds to a given stimulus, and it seems really quite rare, a small probability, sparse coding. But of course, there are 10 to the power 9 neurons in the medial temporal lobes, so that means that more than 10 to the power 6 neurons would have responded to a given stimulus, and probably would have responded to others too. So all we know is that when this patient is shown an image of Jennifer Aniston, several million cells respond in their head. And we have no idea what that means. Yeah. Now, perceptual psychologists have one way of getting at things that could be used here, and that's selective adaptation. And I'm arguing here on this, well, in favour of Gnostic units. My father understood adaptation. He would say, second, when you're taking his tea, second cook's never as good as first. And this is great truth, not only about tea, but about life in general, of course. My father's solution was to have to start with a very large mug. Bonnet postulated that adaptation occurred for his Gnostic units. So if you look too long at one object, or think about one object too long, the corresponding fibers become fatigued. And there is a phenomenon, rather neglected in modern psychology, called semantic satiation. You might have come across this in your own experience. If you take a printed word and stare at it for several minutes or seconds, it loses all meaning. You just see marks on the page. Or if you could try this in your bath, if you just repeat a given word to yourself repeatedly, it loses all meaning. So, can one adapt to identity? Now, we'll try this brief little, it's just a demonstration that I've made to try. I'm going to show you an image that's a morph that I made between two fairly well-known faces. When I show it, if you can identify the component faces, don't say it aloud, because we don't want to spoil it for other people, okay? So, this is my morph, and see if you can identify the components. Now, I'd like you to adapt for a little time to this face. It's an attractive face to look at. As you look at it, say Jennifer Aniston to yourself. And, you know. But I don't want you to adapt low-level feature analyzers in your visual system. So I'd ask you to keep moving around, admire her excellent teeth and her blue eyes, and look around her nose, and keep moving your eye about, but keep intently looking at this image and think Jennifer Aniston. Just adapt as hard as you can to this. Keep looking at it. And I'm trying to get you, of course, if there's anything in your head that's specific to Jennifer Aniston, I'm trying to adapt it. I don't know whether this will work. I haven't tried it on an audience before. Keep moving your eye around. It's important to understand why that is. We don't want low-level adaptation. But just think Jennifer Aniston. Adapt Jennifer Aniston. Keep looking. Keep looking at it. Now, when I do switch back to the morph, keep looking at this. The other identity may only fleetingly be apparent. The adaptation may not last long. But the question is, can you see another identity there in the morph. If you did see it beforehand, well, is it more clear now? So now, try this. Everyone ready? Can you put your hand up if you now saw Hillary Clinton and you didn't initially? Terrific. Good part two project there. Now, I'm afraid I want to, for a little time, talk about some humble psychophysics, which we haven't been quite accidentally led to this, as Tristan thinks. This is the outcome of 20 years' work that goes back to Marina Danilova's thesis on visual psychophysics, and more recently with Chia Takahashi. But these psychophysics have led us to suppose that there must, even if there are Gnostic units at some level, there must be some other kind of representation available in the brain. In our experiments, we present very briefly, while this participant is fixating here, two patches for 100 milliseconds, and in different experiments we studied different attributes. Here we're studying spatial frequency, and the observer is asked to say which is of the higher spatial frequency, say. Or it may be, the question may be about orientation, or it may be about contrast. Classically. Psychophysical discrimination. So just to give you an example, that would be one where the stimuli were close together. So what we vary is the spatial separation of the two stimuli. They're always at the same eccentricity because we don't want to confound eccentricity with spatial separation. But they may be like that, or they may be like that, say, or they may be here and here, so that they actually fall into different hemifields and are delivered to different hemispheres. But the extraordinary thing is that for many visual attributes, the threshold is the same, whether they're juxtaposed or whether they fall into opposite hemifields. Now, we find this deeply mysterious, but we have difficulty interesting anyone else about it. No one else has ever studied it. No one's interested in it. But no one, I mean, how is it going to be explained? How does the human being do this? So this is an example where we're, more recently with Chia Takahashi, where we're studying judgments of speed. The dots are red and green just to make it easy for the observer to respond which is faster. So the two patches may be here, where the centers are 2 degrees apart, or they may be in opposite hemifields or other separations in between. So here are some actual data. In these graphs, the ordinate shows the threshold, the relative threshold, relative to the threshold when they're touching each other. And the x-axis shows the spatial separation in degrees of the graph. And for spatial frequency, for contrast, there's no variation, essentially, with separation. Motion is a very interesting case. For speed, you're just as good at 10 degrees separation as at 2 degrees separation. And it turns out it doesn't even matter if the two patches are moving in opposite, in different directions, opposite or back. But direction is interesting because that deteriorates systematically with separation, and we think that is being performed by local analyzers that are taking the relative direction. So we know there are in the visual system comparator units that take local differences, so disparity deteriorates very quickly in the same way as direction. But for many attributes, there's no deterioration or separation. Now, how are you going to explain this? Well, psychophysicists would traditionally termed two comparator units. What's a comparator unit? Well, here are in, say, visual area one, directionally selective neurons for different parts of the visual field, different local areas. They themselves have taken differences, spatiotemporal differences, to become specific. And we should imagine, perhaps, that the strength of their response is proportional to the speed. So we could have a comparator neuron, which drew inputs of opposite sign from these two lower-level neurons, and that would effectively allow it to compare their speeds.
The trouble with this is that you need an awful lot of these comparator neurons. So,
this is the lower level, and we've made the conservative assumption that there are just four types of motion-sensitive cell at that level for four different directions. But you get a combinatorial explosion if you have this array of units somewhere else that compare every possible pairing at them from the lower level. And it can't be that, well, you could say that in pre-striate areas, receptor fields get bigger, because it's not just that you'd have to add up the signal in the larger area, but you've got to keep track of which local area is which in order to perform our psychophysical task. And in fact, if we put noise in the middle of the field, the threshold is still independent of separation.
We can put numbers on this, I think. Second of Barlow suggests that there are about just over 5,000 hypercolumns in the visual cortex corresponding to this separate areas of the visual field. And if we take those numbers, then we get this estimate of the number of hypercolumns combinations that you would have to solve for. We've made the conservative assumption that for speed there are four types of detector. And we're also making conservative assumption that each of those low-level units can cover the whole range of speeds, which are very unlikely. So the total number of comparator units that you'd need for this arbitrary psychophysical task would be this number, 10 to the power 8. You can argue about the details, but it's of this order. The average number of neurons in 1 cubic millimeter of cortex isn't the order of 10 to the power 4, something more than that. So the amount of cortex you'd need just to do our psychophysical task would be something over 5,000 square millimeters. And then you've got to do similar calculations for hue, saturation, all the other attributes that we've done the experiments for. Very implausible.
So there's a deeper problem. So this is our array of comparator units that's very large because of this combinatorial explosion. But the problem is that the only way you can get this information to other parts of the cortex that might need it is by dedicated lines. And this is the central problem in the talk. That if information is encoded in a Gnostic unit, the representation of one of our comparisons, but a face or a person or a word, then, or a small group of neurons, then the only way you can give that information to the rest of the cortex that need it is with dedicated lines. So
just to elaborate this point, you have a Gnostic unit that represents your mother, your grandmother. Well, maybe you want to deliver that information to Broca's area because you want to greet her. You might have emotional reactions to your grandmother. You may want to associate her with her eau de cologne. You may recognize her voice. You may want to hug her. You may have memories about the blinis that she made when you were a child, and so on. You've got to have all these dedicated connections. And there are two problems, actually. The one that I'm concentrating on, which is the bulk of the long-distance fibers that you would need. But there is a separate issue, which I'm not going to discuss today, but we call it the problem of junk mail. If you have the system like this, you're radiating action potentials in all directions all the time, and action potential is just too expensive to do that. So that's not a problem. Now, what really makes this problem acute is modern knowledge of what a bottleneck the white matter is, even though it occupies 42% of each hemisphere. So there's some classical work by very respectable neuroanatomists, Schüz and Braitenberg, and they try to estimate how much of the white matter is taken up by the long tracts, and how many pyramidal cells have access to them. So, in fact, the long tracts, which lie underneath the bottom of the white matter, really don't have a lot of volume. So these are logarithmic ordinates. The compartment A represents the connections within the cortex. Then the compartment B represents U fibers that run between adjacent areas, which comprises much of the white matter. And then compartment C is the long tracts. And it turns out that only 2% of all pyramidal cells have access to long-distance tracts, and another within a hemisphere, another 2% of access to the corpus closum. And in the last year, what prompts us is that there's DTI work on this by Rosen and Halgren, coming to a similar estimate. Now, they had more than 1,000 participants. They had DTI, diffusion tensor imaging information available to them. Now, of course, the units that DTI gives, streamlines, are arbitrary. So you don't know how many axons they represent. But they cleverly calibrated for this. So there are published estimates on the cross-sections, the density of axons in cross-sections of the corpus closum. And they were able to measure with MRI the cross-section of the corpus callosum in all their participants, which were done in different laboratories. And of course, the corpus callosum is nice because you get a clean transverse section through it, and no complications. And then they could get a ratio of the between axon density and the streamlines for that person's DTI results for other tracks. So they're calibrating themselves. And the long-range connectivity is remarkably sparse. So the median connectivity between any two cortical areas is just over 6,000 axons. But the really astonishing one is that between the hippocampus and the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, there are 10 axons per square millimeter of cortex. And that covers both directions, so maybe half of that, one direction. This shows the estimate of the numbers of axons for different distances for fibers going across the corpus callosum and within the main tracts, within the hemisphere. And one interesting thing would interest any psycholinguists is that between Wernicke's and Broca's area, there are only about 25,000 axons. If you take the conservative estimates of Wernicke's and Broca's area, so just Brodmann's area 44 and the posterior perisylvian language area, if you're more generous, then it goes up to about 58,000. But that covers both directions. Now, the vocabulary of an adult 60-year-old American is of the order of 60,000 lemmas. That's without all the inflection, just the basics of the word. For Cambridge medical students, probably larger. So it looks very unlikely that you have an axon coming from Lobogen's were specific units in Wernicke's or Broca's area, all individually maintained. There are, of course, in the memory field, active at the moment, ideas about how memory depends on ensembles of neurons connected between different brain areas. It's impossible. But you might say, well, the brain has small world features. If there aren't direct communications, then maybe there are indirect ones, so loop between areas. Now, the first thing to be said about this is, well, that would be very wasteful because you have extra axon length and you have extra neuronal bulk. But of course, if this area is a hub, then you've got to consider this, that if this neuron in cortical area B is getting multiple inputs, this neuron doesn't know where the signal came from. Now, you may say, oh, well, there's a temporal difference in that, but you've already admitted that there's a different kind of code. Now, ensemble coding, I've talked about already. The idea that representation is distributed amongst a set of neurons, and there are many forms of this. The question of how big the ensemble is critical. But the problem that's surprisingly little discussed is what is it that recognizes what's in the ensemble, what the pattern is, you know, how you get it out. Well, in some cases, you maybe don't have to go through a process of recognition, so you can do it all just by neural nets. So suppose you're looking at a scene with optic flow in it, and here in MT or in the cortex or in the superior colliculus, there's a population of neurons with different preferred directions, the strongly coloured ones represent the dominant direction. And you could map this distribution directly onto the extrinsic eye muscles without ever recognising anything. And that's fine. But we are cognitive beings, and many of our concepts are discrete entities, so a specific face, specific word, which on which we then perform cognitive operations. And there has to be some way it's recognized. Well, what are you to do? Either you project the whole ensemble forwards, with all the difficulties that are considered, or you could have perhaps what Busacki calls reader neurons, and Edmund Rolls calls dot product decoders. So you would have a reader neuron that collected from a subset of the ensemble and would recognize the presence of this pattern, and another reader neuron that would recognize another subset. But of course, these are Gnostic units. So we have in our world an alternative model, kind of model, the internet. Supposing you want to know the times of the trains from Cambridge to Norwich, if you're wise, you'll use the Deutsche Bahn website, which is most accurate. And so you'll sit at your desk, and a message will be sent with headers about the destination and the origin over national servers to the Deutsche Bahn website. There are multiple routes it could take in cases of congestion or attack by an enemy, and that's why the internet was originally built like this. Or you may want to talk to your grandmother in Edinburgh. So this is the model in our modern world. The information sent in packets, there are alternative routes. There's got to be, of course, an elaborate TCP, transmission control protocol, and a lot of error checking. And you all know how wonderfully it works. So, a long time ago, Marina and I introduced this term cerebral bus for a central bus on which can carry in the brain information from different sources on a common substrate. This term bus is interesting, and it's wonderfully convoluted in its origin. It's the dative plural of the Latin omnes, and there's a French term in the 18th century, voiture, omnibus, which gave us our buses. And then in electrical engineering in England, a bar that supplied voltage or current to a lot of devices would be called an omnibus bar. And now in modern computer terminology, a bus is a common channel that can be shared by different devices, which is the concept we're playing with. So the cerebral bus has to be different from the internet. The internet's made of fiber optics, but we're made of axons, which are very slow in transmission, and yet we can think very quickly. Well, you guys can. The transmission's slow, and action potentials are limited in their temporal position, and how quickly they can follow one another. So the coding in the white matter is likely to depend on many, many parallel lines. And you can ask whether the addresses are transmitted separately, for instance, from the data, and whether transmission control signals are transmitted separately too. Now, you may be saying to yourself, quite rightly, if you're following this talk, well, this is ensemble coding. You're representing things in parallel lines. And indeed, this is the case. So it is. I didn't say all ensemble coding was mistaken, but it's clearly a qualitative range. So I'll give you an analogy with alphabetic scripts. If you wanted to represent a tribute of two cows, you could scratch on a clay tablet two schematic cows. On the other hand, all modern knowledge, pretty well, can be expressed with a Roman alphabet of 26 characters and 10 digits, and ultimately by ones and zeros on an internet circuit. And so it's a matter of degree as to where it becomes, where it stops being ensemble coding, becomes general coding. But I do allow that. Now, if you allow that the brain centrally is a communications network, there are all sorts of questions that arise that are not being asked. So, is information transmitted only on request? So our way of thinking about attention is that it's requests for information. That's what attention is. I've mentioned this one, our sources and destinations carried by different fibres. Is information sent in packets or is it continuous? Is there a clock? Is there alternative route? This is, of course, very interesting from a rehabilitation point of view as to whether either in normal operation of the brain, when there's congestion, you can use alternative routes as you can on the internet, which requires a code that is general. This is part of this distinction I'm making between very local ensemble coding and a general code. I don't know. Now, this is very important, and no one seems to think about this, but how is the speed of transmission modulated? What sort of handshaking is there between transmitter and receiver? You can't just throw information from one end of the brain to another, because the buffers may overflow at the receiving end. Any man-made system has to have handshaking to control the buffers. And if that's not there, then you might expect to get pathologies. And are there protocols for error checking, as there are on man-made systems? Now, what about transmission control protocols? We have a suggestion about this. I mentioned earlier these large axons that will transmit very quickly, but you can't. It would be very costly to transmit continuously on them. So we think that these might be carrying the TCP. And those signals are likely to be very stereotyped and big action potentials. So they could be easily recorded. And it might be possible to get a handle on the TCP before anyone solved what the data code was. I mean, I think it's acutely interesting to know what these are. And I can tell you where to find some of these. So just to elaborate, this is a Chio Takahashi's concept of a section through the frontal occipital fasciculus. So the prefrontal cortex may be sending data requests, acts, and data signals about the coordinates of the parts, the visual field that information is wanted about, go over these thinner axons. And then there are signals going in the other way, acknowledging the request, saying the data's ready, and so on. Now, you might ask, well, if only 4% of pyramidal cells have access to long axons, who are they? You know. Is there something that identifies these pyramidal cells? Another question that no one talks about. But there are some interesting characters in the old histology. This is a section through, I think, probably primate visual cortex. This is area 18, this is area 17. And you can see this characteristic tuning fork structure of the granular matter that it famously distinguishes the boundary between 17 and 18. Just above the granular layer, just at the edge, is a region of giant pyramidal cells, very provocative set of cells. It is known from classical histology that if you cut the corpus callosum, they degenerate. And there's old German literature showing that there's some very thick axons coming out of here. Von Economo wonderfully called this area the limes parastriatus gigantopyramidalis. And here's one of his sections in layer three here. You can see these very large pyramidal cells even in the scale. And these cells do have some interesting features. This is some old work by Brock and Brock. This is a typical pyramidal cell of normal size with all these spines on the apical dendrite. These characters are these giant pyramidal cells that are found. They're found at the junction of 17 and 18 on the 18 side. They're also found at the termination of the arteriate vesicles in varicose area. They have very few spines on the apical dendrite. They have an excess number of synaptic contacts on the cell body. As I said, they're just in layer three. And as I said, they also occur in varicose area. So I think it would be very interesting to know more about these. This is just speculation. There might be histological specifications that would make obvious what the circuit was at the encoding or the decoding stage. So we're just coming to 5:30. Here are the conclusions. This question that Charles Bonnet raised in 1755 is unanswered. Is the brain all one neural net, or is centrally it a communications network? For a large range of visual attributes, human beings can discriminate stimuli with the same precision when they're 10 degrees apart in opposite hemispheres as they can when they're together, and that needs explanation. And we've suggested that the information is carried to the site of comparison by a cerebral bus, which ties with the visual field coordinates and the signal strength. And more generally, the idea that people, words, concepts, and the results of our sensory comparisons in our experiments, it's unlikely that they're represented only by the response of dedicated neurons. So the problem is that in that kind of model, the information's imprisoned in the cell. It can't move. The only way you can send the information somewhere else is with a dedicated one. And most versions of ensemble coding face a similar problem, except extreme cases where the ensemble is a general code. Thank you, Tristan.
It's customary, if you need to go, you can go now, we give you a couple of minutes. But if you want to stay, then those who are really brave for a good discussion can stay. And then we resume the discussion for those who have to leave.
Maybe if
Excellent. I'm glad for those who stay. Not that I don't like those who left, because I don't care about them anymore. love them, you know, at the time. So, excellent. I'm happy to coordinate a discussion. I mean, John is perfectly capable of doing that, but since I would like you to raise your hand and ask questions.
We know that quite a few of these long-range fiber bundles thin during postnatal development, and so I'm just wondering whether, whether I could persuade you into a model where, initial sort of representations get set up in a more distributed kind of way. And then subsequently, the loss of roughly 50% of these white matter fibers, in the corpus callosum, for example, in postnatal development. So you're moving toward a communication system. But you originally set things up in a more distributed way.
It's an interesting thought, and I haven't read as much as I should about it. The infant brain, of course, is tinier, and one truth, so it might be ontogeny reflecting phylogeny. The mouse is completely connected, and as you go through the mammals, the connections get sparser. So one answer would be that infants are still at the earlier stage of phylogeny. But your idea is perfectly plausible.
Thanks for a very insightful talk. So, thinking about the brain and the network through the metaphors of a computer or an information network, isn't that potentially dangerous because we apply the same constraints of these man-made structures to a biological entity? And secondly, thinking about various models of information processing, that isn't it possible that your brain just extracts different levels of information and puts that incomplete picture in order to create these representations, rather than the information just being passed on in a physical sense?
The first point is a classical one, and of course we must all be cautious of that. On the other hand, man-made models have traditionally indicated what we should think about, what constraints we should But I'm not saying brains like the internet or computer. We don't know what it's like. That's what I'm saying. And it's not like a big neural net, you could be sensitive or set. The second point is that we do, certainly, possibly not in the case of audition, but in the case of vision, we have access for decision making to all the levels. That in audition, it may be that you can understand speech, but you can't identify the underlying features. But in vision, you can attend to the colour or the features of the letters and so on, as well as to all the levels in between and the identity of the letters. So it's not just that the system produces gnostic units and you know it's your grandmother, you don't know anything else. That's not the question.
Historiographically, is Lashley worth a footnote? leisurely mass action. Or is it is that a distraction? I mean, the issue as it was represented in the 30s would seem to have some alignment with the two poles of your dilemma, but maybe that's not helpful to be historiographically complete.
Well, I mean, it's beyond question that the brain has about, in each hemisphere, about 180 specialized areas. That's doing lots of jobs. And that is incompatible with what
this confusion.
So it's what I'm interested in.
But the ceramic glass is quite confusing, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. Did he cut into the white matter?
I don't see how he could avoid it.
I think that is exactly what he did, isn't it?
It's a bit like the washer in The Merchant of Venice. You can have some flesh, but you're not going to take any blood. I don't think at that time you could do the surgery without destroying the white matter.
Awesome. But horizontal lines, quite simple, the vertical.
I guess I'm a little confused about this problem you said about how information is trapped in cells. The way I understand ensemble encoding is just like distributed networks representing information. So if you're saying that it's trapped, a lot of like anatomical and functional evidence shows that across different like cognition of like perception, action, like visual attention, object recognition are all like done by overlapping distributed networks. Give you the proof.
Yeah. I mean, what's the evidence?
There are papers like doing like imaging of
the imaging can't tell you anything about it.
And also the structural network by doing like BTI and like functional by doing MRI and so on, constructing like connectomes.
Can't really get down to this level. I mean, imaging can't tell you what is being transmitted at the moment.
But there are brain activities during like certain tasks, and the brain activities is distributed across the brain.
That's blood flow. I mean, it's not. What's happening is you're talking to me very coherently. It's a huge amount of information going to and fro across your artery. It's not something that you can see.
But I guess I don't really understand what you mean by information being trapped in cells. Because if you're talking about like information being accessible in the immediate present for generating action, for example, the visual information for generating action, it could just be represented in the present as you view like an object globally, and that is because of it being global, accessible to like decision-making systems. But if you're talking about like accessing information in your memory, then that could be specialized, localized systems for memory. But if you're just talking, so I'm not really sure what you mean by like information being trapped.
I think there's a difference in the way that information is being characterized.
Explain,
but you should explain what you mean by information.
Well, I just mean when you see something or when you touch something, that input is being represented in your brain in some way, and that could be represented by just the network dynamics in the present time as you're viewing the thing. And because it's represented distributively across the brain, it would be accessible for multiple different systems, like taking an action or speaking, and so on and so forth, because it's represented in this network way.
What this dramatic data from Rosen
objects is that there just aren't enough long-range connections to support that kind of model.
But
it's very popular kind of model.
I guess there'll have to be long-range connections in terms of like platforms, just be like different activities like going around.
You did
mention that, I think, local activity.
You
did incorporate that idea.
Yes. Loads of them have local access. How the long-range connections in the brain.
Maybe the point is that it doesn't take information transfer to get co-activation of distant networks. Maybe that's how that would be.
Imaging is just there's one extraordinary thing that's never discussed, which is that there's a finite amount of volume in the brain. If you take it from one place, it can't be in another place. So there's got to be a negative correlation between this area and another area when you do fMRI, for instance. All that fMRI can show you is blood flow, it's plumbing. It can't show you any real details.
I think
it is controversial. I mean, I think it's very easy, though, for us to interpret imaging data with our theories, which is the wrong way around. I think what John is saying is that's not the data that you need to prove a kind of information network. Theory, because it's blood flow as opposed to all the other types of evidence. Is that right?
Yes, I mean, my frontal cortex sends a request for information to part of the visual, to the visual cortex, and you'll find activity probably in both areas. But that doesn't tell you the nature of what's being transmitted.
Yeah, thank you very much, John. I really enjoyed this talk. I mean, I became very frustrated as a data scientist that we didn't criticize enough what channel over which information was conveyed in the brain. So lovely to see you question and reflect on that. I was curious, I think part of the attraction of thinking about things in terms of neural nets is that it's also consistent with localization. And you know that you can get very specific disruptions to particular aspects of perception given lesions to particular areas of the brain. So, and you did say that you think it's plausible that some things are still computed as sort of neural nets, localized neural nets. I was curious how you see the balance between that, like what is localized for neural net, and what are the features that require maybe a temporal code over long distance connections.
Yeah, well, that's the kind of issue that I'm really. It's a classical issue between connections and symbolic AI. And there are 180 local models in one hemisphere. They do probably behave like neural nets, and there are many different properties of the nets suited to that particular local purpose. The question is whether the whole thing is one.
So the comparison to the internet. With an internet, the way internet communicates is through essentially headers that say this message needs to be directed to this address.
Yeah.
And so in that sense, the data is encoded in the same medium as the addressing. Is that plausible? Is it plausible that there's a code, a spiking code, that says this needs to go to prefrontal cortex? How would you see that work?
Yeah, it could be that you have addresses. It could be what's being manipulated are addresses, just the addresses of representations. But then you put out another code. Our suggestion is that maybe the biggest axons are carrying the TCP, the cryptography, then other axons are carrying the coordinates as the addresses, and then another one is carrying the data. But there may be mixed or something. I mean, we've no idea.
But what would that code look like? What would the TCP code look like?
TCP? The TCP code would be just very stereotyped signals on those big axons, meaning buffers, plus, things like that. But what the code would be for
addressing
it. But if your model is that everything is connected to everything else in the brain,
what methods would you use to take these questions forward?
Histology and electrophysiology, looking at the potential hubs, these giant downward cells, to see if this local circuitry suggests what's happening at the terminations and the origins of the brain tracts. That's all I know. I mean, there's no way any form of modern imaging can come into that. But electrophysiological recordings from the terminations of the tracts.
Is it possible there's some quantum mechanics needed or some understanding in genomics, for example? We still can't explain how downstream influences trigger certain imaging.
Yeah.
So would the brain be equivalent to that?
There are always possibilities, and indeed we're interested in the engram, the nature of memory. And if you believe, some people do, that you can't work memory with neural nets, we can't separate the representations from the processing. And there are alternatives, and there are, for instance, around the models of memory. So, yes, we may well go inside the cell, being to a quantum level, but I don't. That's the quantum level. The quantum level is quite very not driven there yet. Possibly. In fact, where did we go from there?
There was a question just behind you first.
Sorry. Jeez, first of all, yeah, thank you for like such a fascinating talk. So I'm quite interested in like conceptualizing this notion of like a cerebral bus and the communications network. So like if you think in terms of the internet, you say, okay, I want to start in England, I'll end up in France, and then I'll lay my cable. And you have your start point and your endpoint predetermined, and then you lay the cable. I was thinking, in terms of a cerebral bus, in this kind of modelling, to what degree is the development of these tracks kind of predetermined, or is there any wiggle room for individual differences in that regard?
Well, there certainly are individual differences in the thickness. There are also claims that there's plasticity, even in the adult. Mark Johnson was raised that point actually about the human embryo, where there's loss of axons in the white matter. So this, but I assume that genetically that is the basic.
You've given imaging, I think, a long-deserved hard time. And many of us have done a wee bit of it at some stage in our lives along the way. Should we still bother to read any imaging papers, for example, those on diffusion tensor imaging?
Yeah, I read them. I mean, it's interesting to know what the connection is. And in fact, this talk is inspired by the Rosen and Halgren paper, which is having
if I could just clarify for So do you think, to answer this question, we should really figure out how the circuits are connected, just the connections of the network, the structure of the network? Do you think that's the key to answering this question?
No, there's a huge amount of work on that. I mean, there is a lot of good DTI work. What we need to know is what's being transmitted between areas. And the trouble is, if you read papers in the image, you feel it, what was it sort of, in a 19th century way about excitation and inhibition being transmitted. Information's being transmitted at very high rates, and we have no idea of how that's being done.
Like the format of the information?
Both the format and the control signals. We're not here.
Thank you for the talk. I didn't know about the white matter bottleneck, so that was very interesting. But I was also wondering, are there potentially other ways of transmission, like through the astrocytes? And how much can individual cells actually carry out a particular function? So you talked about neurons that read information, and then there could be axons that transmit information. But also like the astrocytes, you have the white matter astrocytes that also communicate with the axons. And then some people, this is like new research, believe the idea of lateral potentiation. So you have astrocytes covering many tens of thousands of synapses.
Mm-hmm.
So could they have a role in representing information?
Yes,
you could.
But the actual core parts of the tracts, well, they're sort of astrocytes, but I'm sure.
But you've got a question from the network scientist.
I'm afraid I'm a plumber by profession. No, I do neuroimaging. I wonder if you're familiar with the decoding research, MBPA, things like that, representational similarity.
You mean decoding fMRI?
Yeah, pattern selectivity.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, so I think I missed a step in your talk, and I will try and understand it further down, but we can decode a face, say, in the classical face area, but also in the parahippocampal gyrus, but also in the subcortex, also in the frontal cortex. And this is like, we have no idea what we're decoding, or how this goes along, but it's statistically significant, you said. So I was wondering how this information fits into your ideas, if you try to connect them.
You know the set of your stimuli,
mm-hmm.
So it's very limited.
People have expanded it, but yeah, it is limited.
It's a limited set. And I would be perfectly happy if the right fusiform gyrus was like a neural net and you could identify a few faces from the distribution activity. But I'm still interested in how that information is transmitted elsewhere, owing to the white matter problem.
But wouldn't the fact that we can find this information with reliable, we don't know what the information is again, but with a certain reliability across the courses, it's indicate that the representation is distributed? And I think I miss your argument as to why it cannot be distributed. Well, you said there were some qualifications you made.
I'm not sure that the fact that you get an increase in blood flow.
It's not increases.
Or change in blood flow.
Yeah.
In a lot of box cells shows you how low crystals distribute all the infections. But of course, I mean, the recognition depend would, if there were local representations. But there's got to be a lot of processing and a lot of feature analysis in that area.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know which foxes are doing what.
Great. some more activated than others.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. In fact, we need machines to decode this because humans cannot look at all the voxels and they sense a little pattern.
I'm very jaundiced about modern engineering. One lovely thing to think about is this claim recently that originated a couple thousand miles from here, that obese people have weak correlations, functional correlations, and that this implies no one discusses the plumbing. I mean, the obese people, we don't even know whether obese people have the same volume as other people, but we might expect their vascular system not to be as responsive. So, and you guys would see a weak correlation.
Would you say it's different because you were talking about fMRI decoding and that kind of stuff? And you were talking about plumbing and economy making pressures on information transfer based on, well, plumbing. But if you do the same analysis in MEG, for example, and you work across that as well, that's not plumbing, then that's relaxivity, that's recorded. Would you see a difference
there? It's got the temporal resolution, but it still doesn't really tell you what's going on underneath. And there's this sinister assumption always with electrophysiological work of that kind, that the bigger the signal, the more processing it is, which is doubt, because if a particular area is processing maximally, the activities of cells are decorrelated. You only get big signals when you're getting correlated responses and very little information.
Yeah, no, I guess my main point was just about the point you made earlier about this kind of distributed information in different areas in the brain that you can't really make inferences that it's actually that's distributed information based on the blood flow. That's the kind of thing I'm
questioning.
Can you assume that with MEG and EEG? No, yes.
Concerning the interesting point about synchronization in neurocoding, might it not be better to postulate a non-linear function? That's to say, if you've got zero correlation, you've got randomness. So in a sense, in sense of maximum entropy, there's a hell of a lot of information, but there's no structure, therefore there's no information in the sense that we would like to have information. So maybe, you know, there's an intermediate level which gives maximum informativeness in the sense that, well, this is something I like it, do something that I could interpret in relation to something else. But I absolutely agree with you that, you know, maximum explosive electrophysiological responses could mean very little indeed, the non-linearity.
You're reaching a point where we should try to continue this discussion honed in alcoholic or non-alcoholic beverages. Not that I wouldn't want to have the, you know, last question, but I'm going to reserve it for the pub.
Thank you. And the speaker would like a gin and tonic.
Richly deserved.
Yeah. Will you join me in thanking John again? Bear in mind it's Friday and the tables have turned after COVID. We'll try to go to all bar one. If you don't know, just follow me. We meet in 5 minutes in the entrance. It's a good standing bar. There's not that many people because it's not a pub. So that's a good idea to go there first. And then those who have signed up for the dinner or those like the ones who just jump in the new bus can come with us to the house, the house die at 7:30. So, guys, you know, see you 5 outside, 7.
we need more of that.
But there are some things to the extent of like the
follow-up. I'll edit the talk later.
To cut, because I don't think it's the...